This isn't a place that overwhelms. Acadia has never been like that. Among national parks, it is small, possessing no single spectacle, no Old Faithful, no Grand Canyon. Acadia doesn't reach out and grab you. It invites you in to explore its small secrets. It forces nothing upon you, but offers much. The gifts of Acadia, and they are many, are simple. The phrase Gift of Acadia can be taken several ways. First, of course, it is the spectacular gift given us by God, crafted by nature. Second, it is a gift given us by people, men of exceeding vision generations ago. Third, it is a gift that if we are fully to appreciate it, we, with some effort, must give ourselves. And fourth, it is a gift that we then are called upon to preserve for those who will follow. Begin with nature. Start with the sea. The eternal sea, beneath which 500 million years ago sediments were deposited and pressed and hardened. And in geologic time, they would rise from the sea as rock, only then to be crushed under the mile-thick ice of glaciers, advancing, then receding again and again, until finally the rock could rise once more, this time its tops blunted and scoured. Some still held by the sea and called islands, some rising free as mountains. By some measure, these may seem nubby hills, but in fact, that upthrust of granite called Cadillac, its wrinkled, bald head gazing out at the sea from 1,530 feet up, is the highest mountain on our nation's east coast. But ignore that, and disregard the claim sometimes made that here is where each day the sun first touches American soil. Geographers figure now that's not quite correct. So forget those, but that's all right, because Acadia is not a place for superlatives. On the contrary, Acadia reminds a society sated with superlatives, highest, biggest, fastest, richest, that there are other, better values. The value of solitude, and in solitude, contemplation. The value of diversity, and in diversity, harmony. Acadia is a meeting ground where the irresistible meets the immovable and patiently will move it. Where monarchs of sky meet monarchs of sea. Where flora and fauna of the boreal north commingle with those of the temperate south, enriching Acadia with matchless diversity. Where season meets season meets season, and in their timeless turnings echo other main voices.
I cannot hold thee close enough. Thy winds, thy wide gray skies, thy mists that roll and rise, thy woods this autumn day that ache and sag and all but cry with color, that gaunt crag to crush, to lift the lean of that black bluff. World, world, I cannot get thee close enough. Glory in it all, but never knew I this. Here such a passion is that stretches me apart. Lord, I do fear thou'st made the world too beautiful this year. Edna St. Vincent Millay.
Thank you. A bitter gale over frozen snow burns the skin like hail. It is 12 below. Too cold to live, too cold to die. Warm animals wait and make no cry. Their feathers puff, their eyes are bright, their fur expands. Warm animals wait. They make no sign, they waste no breath in this cold country between life and death. May Sarton.
If spring came but once in a century instead of once a year, or burst forth with the sound of an earthquake and not in silence, what wonder and expectation there would be in all hearts to behold the miraculous change. But now the silent succession suggests nothing but necessity. To most men, only the cessation of the miracle would be miraculous. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow.
Season to season, it is a splendid place nature has crafted. But if Acadia is a gift given by nature, it is also, in another sense, a gift bequeathed us by people. Who were the first people here? Anthropologists aren't sure. Perhaps those mysterious people of prehistory they call the red paint people. Surely Abnaki Indians, leaving inland homes for summers at the sea, summers of canoeing, fishing, clamming, basket weaving, they were Acadia's first summer people. The first European to come this way? In 1604, the French explorer Champlain, mapping what was called New France, passed by the bald heads of granite, and was he too distracted? His ship ran aground, perhaps it is thought, off this very point of land. While his men made repairs, Champlain made a name. The island of Bear Mountains, he called this place L'Île de Mont Désert, Mount Desert, or Mount Desert. Either. Or either. In the wake of Champlain came the first settlers, French Jesuits, soon killed or driven out by English war parties, and that was the start. For years, French gunboats hid behind islands in what one day would be called Frenchman's Bay and ambushed English warships. For years, this was a warring place. When peace came, New France became New England. But another name which French cartographers had given this stretch of coast stuck: Acadia. It was also a Frenchman who laid claim to these lands, a French commoner who had made up a nobleman's title for himself. Sieur de Cadillac is how he passed himself off, here and later in Michigan, where he founded Detroit. That was 300 years ago. His made-up name lives on. For early settlers here, life was hard. This, after all, was frontier. As late as 1790, wolves and wildcats still roamed the new town, which was named Eden. Did settlers, despite hardships, find this a paradise? If so, it remained their secret till the mid-1800s. It was artists, Thomas Cole, Frederick Church, others of what was called the Hudson River School of American Painting, who in the 1840s brought sketchbook and pencil, canvas and oil, to capture Acadia's specialness as they were captured by it. Once their pictures were seen back in New York, Boston, and Philadelphia, New York, Boston, and Philadelphia began coming too. At first, they called themselves rusticators. And the hastily erected hotels, however grand they appeared, were rustic. Rodick House, largest resort hotel in America at one time, had no private baths. When the wealthy started building their own mansions, they still pretended rusticity and called their mansions cottages. By the late 1800s, the summer cottages of Pulitzer, Ford, Vanderbilt, Morgan, many of the richest of America's rich, made Bar Harbor society a rival of Newport. There was culture at a grand palace of arts, sporting life at Kibo Racetrack, in whose infield was constructed one of the nation's earliest golf courses, and the Boston Symphony played on the lawns, and the wealthy enjoyed. But some of the wealthy decided to do more than just enjoy this special place. They were special people. George B. Dorr, man of wealth and valuable Washington contacts. Charles Eliot, principal president of Harvard. John D. Rockefeller Jr., inherited fortune, innate good taste. These and other foresightful men in the early 1900s began purchasing lands across the island, not for themselves, for us, for the future, for preservation. It may be hard to imagine today, but once they had assembled those lands, it took considerable convincing to persuade the federal government to accept them, first as a national monument, then in 1919, as the first national park east of the Mississippi, and the first anywhere comprising solely donated lands. It was benefaction on a scale rarely seen. In those days, it was so serene to ride to Jordan Pond of an afternoon in a Surrey or cut-under, have tea and popovers at the foot of the hills called the Bubbles, serene. But for how long? As long as it could, Mount Desert managed to prohibit automobiles. Tourists arrived by steamship, tooting across from the railroad terminus on Hancock Point. But it was bound to happen. The law changed, and here they came. What an irony. John D. Rockefeller Sr. had sold the nation oil to fuel internal combustion. John D. Rockefeller Jr. would give the nation one small way to escape it. Mr. Rockefeller hired workmen and commenced building carriage roads. He loved building roads. He chose the routes himself to showcase the vistas he treasured. They would be roads for horses, roads for carriages, roads for walkers, roads perhaps for bikers. But never, he stipulated, would motor cars be permitted. To carry the carriage roads, and all this took 27 years to accomplish, his artisans shaped matchless granite bridges, each designed for its unique setting. Soaring granite parapets over Duck Brook, humble cobblestone arching Jordan Stream. In all, Mr. Rockefeller gave 43 miles of carriage roads and 16 bridges and two magnificent granite gatehouses all to us, the nation. Trusting the nation to maintain them, we will have to talk about that. But for now, the point is to celebrate the human vision that made Acadia. Two things would end Mount Desert's golden years. The first was man-made, the income tax. The second was natural. The fire of 47 burned out of control 11 days, burned 17,000 acres, burned most of the mansions, burned a lifestyle, burned an era. So today, there are not the indulgences of wealth here to attract attention. But there is still Acadia. It is not easy, the hike up precipice trail. Some foolishly undertake it ill-equipped and fall victim. But those who are prepared and diligent can learn a great lesson here. The lesson of honest effort rewarded. That life's most valuable prizes don't come from a lottery's draw, but from one's own exertion. In this sense, the gift of Acadia is one that we, through our own strivings, must give ourselves. It is possible to do it the easy way. There are standard visitors' routes, and they offer a good introduction. The Park Loop Road, delivers one pleasantly past Sand Beach, spread below magnificent Great Head. Past Thunder Hole, which in truth usually whispers, but with the proper coincidence of storm and swell and tide, thunders indeed. Over and around Otter Cliffs, winding 20 miles along classic Maine coast and inland through forest. Connecting with that road which climbs the rocky flanks of Cadillac, this is the route most visitors take. It gives a good overview of Acadia, encompassing the busy places where it can be hard to find parking and impossible to find solitude. But in its heart, Acadia is wonderfully unbusy places. Not all marked on tourist maps, or they would not be unbusy. But with effort, you can find them. They wait to be found by any who will realize that the best gifts don't wear signs. No arrows point to them. They are precious private pockets of peace. They are solitude. For anyone seeking inspiration, it lives in places like this. But of course, Acadia is more than chasing muses in the woods. It is more than those acres on Mount Desert Island that are most visited. There are several Acadias. The rough, raw, rock-bound Skudik Peninsula. And off the coast, Isle of Ho, High Island, as Champlain named it. A trip to Isle of Ho transports one across water and worlds. Half the island is national park, and here you feel the sort of people that are Acadia. Stalwarts who, for generations, have wrested livelihoods from the sea, ever attuned to nature's pulse. Yet another Acadia is winter. How different it is in winter. It reminds us that whatever season, a way to give yourself the gift of Acadia is exert and enjoy. Thank you. There is much to do in Acadia, and there is much to learn. Park rangers are happy to share their knowledge. Geology, ornithology, the life of the tide pool, the stars. Choose a tour to suit your interests, or better, to develop new interests.
It's a glacial erratic, as we call it. And it's believed that it was carried to the top of Acadia Mountain by glacial ice. When you remember that there might have been several thousand feet of ice covering this land at one time, carrying big boulders with them and then dropping them off at certain places along the way. Now, geologists have done some poking around in Maine, and they found that some of these erratics, such as the ones on the tops of the mountains around here, originated about 20 miles to the north of us.
Sometimes they're in clusters of two, sometimes in clusters of three, and sometimes in clusters of five, but it's a genetic thing, so any given species of pine will be consistent. There are four common kinds of pine trees in Acadia, okay? And this one right here is called a white pine.
You're all sitting on the rocks that make up the coast. What is the predominant type of rock?
Granite.
Granite, right, very good. And let me talk to you about how that granite was formed. The original rock that formed Mount Desert Island was sedimentary rock, and it was laid down in layers. And then what happened was a large plug of magma, magma is molten rock from beneath the surface of the earth, came up. I've read that that plug of magma was about 8 miles in diameter.
70% of the rocks at this point would break different than you wanted them to. Up to 70% of the rocks were mistakes, and they weren't fit for going into the bridge. So what they would use those for is the coping stones we've seen, or filler in the base of the bridge where you're standing now.
You know, if they build a bridge today, you'd have the bridge end, right? Mm-hmm. But he would always have like this entryway, grand entryway, and you know, the curve follows along and then ends. And then look at the work done along the other side, along the hill. All of this, all as we walk, those are called coping stones and just foundation stones to prevent erosion and to keep that road as it is, so no erosion would occur.
Roads, but also about the way that his bridges were constructed. And actually, by this time, the stone makes...
Much to learn, and the learning is one more way you give yourself the gift. It is a gift for all your senses, each one of them. It isn't enough just to see Acadia. Smell it. Breathe its aromas. The Christmas scent of balsam fir. The musk of moss and bog. The tang of the sea. The exhilaration of pure fresh air. These are smells that you taste as well. And the sense of touch. Touch the stiff bristle of spruce, the soft brushing of pine, the grain of granite, the smoothness of rock worked by water, and while at water, listen. You may think you have found a quiet cove, a silent glade, but nature knows no silence. Listen to the quiet music of Acadia. and finally turn again to the sense of sight, but see in new ways. Look at color, vivid, saturated color. Soft, subtle tints and hues. Look at color and look at light. Squint. See the mystical magic light can do. Feel fog. With all your senses, know this place. Acadia. We have thought of it as a gift given us by nature, as a gift which people of foresight decades ago bequeathed to us, as a gift which, with effort and perception, we give ourselves.
And finally, it is a gift that we must help preserve for those who come after. We said when Mr. Dorr and Mr. Elliott gathered these lands and gave them to the nation, when Mr. Rockefeller built the roads and bridges and gave them to the nation, they depended on the nation to take care of them. Well, we are the nation. To preserve places like this is the gift that we are asked to give. It is called stewardship.
Look around. There are many worthy examples of stewardship to be found here. Hop on a bus. One of the propane-powered, non-polluting Island Explorer buses. Ride around and through the park. From hotel to village to campground to beach to trailhead, and all for free. Continuing gift of convenience from people who care. The organization Friends of Acadia is a splendid example of stewardship. In addition to contributing to the Island Explorer, it has been responsible for raising millions of dollars to restore and perpetually maintain Acadia's carriage roads. Friends of Acadia arranged for purchase of special carriages so that the handicapped might enjoy those unique roads. Turning its attention to hiking trails, it raised more millions of dollars and thousands of hours of volunteer labor to repair existing trails and renew miles of abandoned trails. Acadia Trails Forever, the campaign was called, because these trails are now permanently endowed to ensure their continued care. Nothing like it has ever been done in this country. But then, no other place has quite the heritage of caring, of giving, of volunteering, of bringing out the best in people, as does Acadia. Isn't this place worth it? Look again. This time see as the eagle sees Acadia. Acadia, it is so many things. It is nature primeval, the ceaseless clash of elemental forces. It is the people who have derived their livings and their pleasures from it. It is a place of peace and grace, preserved by people of vision, needing now us and our vision. It is a place which some will know in person, others only through pictures like these and a friend's vivid recollections. But whether Acadia exists in our lives, our memories, or just our dreams, it is something we need. For what it is, what it reminds, what it teaches, what it challenges. We need the gift of Acadia.